sin of lust. And anytime I think of this sin, and of the opposite virtue, but especially of the sin, I recall what St. Paul said in one of his epistles. Speaking of this sin, he said, "Let it not even be named among you, as becomes saints." Sadly, however, we know the reality that, as Our Lady said, so many souls go to hell, more souls go to hell for this sin than for any other. And the particular tragedy of this sin is that it enchains the person who becomes addicted, so much so that he can hardly, without an enormous amount of grace and effort, free himself from the chains of this vice. So I'll begin by reading a section from this book. "Lust is the inordinate appetite for the carnal pleasure which is experienced in the functioning of the generative organs. This pleasure in itself is no more sinful than the pleasures attached to taste, smell, the comfortable feeling of warmth, and other sensitive feelings. And just as the pleasure of eating is implanted by God in man so that he may willingly sustain his own life, so the carnal pleasure of which we speak is given to man that he may willingly propagate the race. The appetite for this carnal pleasure is inordinate. When the pleasure is sought, either in a way that cannot possibly subserve the purpose for which man has the appetite, or when it is excessively sought, although in a legitimate way. It is sought in a way that cannot subserve rational ends when it is sought outside true wedlock, whether by means of the generative act or otherwise. This is always grievously sinful if the pleasure is directly procured, or even deliberately consented to after it has arisen spontaneously. However slight the pleasure, it is a matter of grievous sin, provided there are present full advertence and full consent. The causes, however, which lead to the excitation of the pleasure may be venially sinful if they are slight causes. Nevertheless, the Catholic conscience, especially in the case of those who have had a careful religious training, is very sensitive and instinctively shrinks from even slight causes, such as the slightest immodesty, which might lead further on the road to self-indulgence. This sensitiveness is instinctive in all children after a certain age, and long before they have experienced any tendency to lust, but it is unfortunately deadened by evil surroundings and non-religious teaching. The pleasure is excessively sought after in wedlock when marital relations are indulged in with an unnecessary risk to health and vigor. But as in everything else, what is moderation for one person may be excess for another. Lust is a capital vice because the carnal pleasure of which we are speaking is so attractive to the majority of mankind that man is led into all kinds of disorders in order to gratify his fleshly desires. In certain periods of the world, it has raised its head shamelessly and has worked great havoc. It threatens to devitalize the peoples of today through race suicide. Theologians use that term for contraception. A practice that has become so widespread that the nations appear to be on a steep slope of vital exhaustion. Now, this was written in 1945. The results to which lust more generally give rise are, and he lists seven results. Number one, blindness of intellect in respect to divine things. Number two, precipitancy in acting without judgment. Three, a want of regard for what befits one's state or person. Number four, inconstancy in good. Number five, hatred of God as an avenger of such sins. Number six, love of this world and of its pleasures. And number seven, an inordinate fear of death. So he's saying those are the results of those of this sin for those who give into it. Now, this is the most important paragraph, the remedies. The remedies against this vice are to ask God humbly for the gift of continency, to shun pride, which is often punished by a fall in to be moderate in food and drink, not to expose oneself to temptation in this matter, however great one's imagined strength, to avoid unnecessary and familiar conversation with those of the opposite sex, to meditate on the passion of our Lord and on the four last things, frequently to approach the sacraments of penance and the Holy Eucharist, to walk in the presence of God, to have a special devotion to the Immaculate Mother of God, to shun idle curiosity, to be natural and not morbid and prurient in one's outlook on life. Now that's a long list of spiritual practices that help us to cultivate the virtue of chastity and to safeguard ourselves against danger. And this is very important for parents in particular. And in fact, I might add, vigilance over their children and their entertainments and their companions and so forth. And especially we know today where the sense of modesty has been so deadened by the constant barrage of suggestive songs, movies, television, billboards, pictures, the internet, everywhere. And so we must particularly be on our guard. However, we must also remember that in whatever age of the history of the world God places an individual, he's going to give that individual the graces necessary if we do our part. So we shouldn't despair and say, I live in such an evil time, it's impossible, or it's too difficult, because God will give us the grace. And this list, I would like to go back to the very first thing he says of the remedies, to ask God humbly for the gift of continency. We've talked about this before, 2 weeks ago when we covered the capital sin of pride, that humility is so pleasing to God, it draws him, it draws his graces. As our Lord himself said, God rejects the proud and gives his grace to the humble. So there's a story told about a Jesuit priest, and this is probably late 16th or 17th century, who was a confessor to the queen and members of the court in Spain. And as a result of his office, he was compelled to be present for various court ceremonies. And someone asked him once, said, how do you preserve yourself? You, in your vow of chastity, in your state of celibacy, how do you safeguard it? Because you're surrounded by all of this opulence, all of the colorful garments that the various courtiers of the king wear, and the ceremonies, and all of the women here, and so forth. He said, how do you guard yourself? And the priest said, with the virtue of humility, that I constantly remind myself how weak I am, and then I go to God for strength. It is when we lose sight of our weakness, in other words, when we fail to be humble, that we are in danger of falling. And one of the interesting things he says here is that, and I'll read it, to shun pride, which is often punished by a fall into this vice. We find individuals down through history who gave into pride and rebellion, such as heretics, that they often ended up becoming immersed in this vice as a just punishment for their pride. So that list is important. Again, humility, prayer, avoiding occasions of sin, not trusting too much in our own strength, thinking, oh, I can handle this, and, you know, looking at something or watching a program or something that is indecent, but rather to flee and humbly recognize our weakness, and of course, the sacraments, frequentation of confession, Holy Communion, meditation on the passion of our Lord, deep devotion to our Blessed Mother, and I might add, fostering a devotion to a saint that is known for chastity. We have St. Joseph, for example, St. Philomena, St. Aloysius, all of the virgin martyrs, St. Agnes, etc., and really any saint for that matter. But that is a very powerful means. Also, the sacramentals, holy water, very powerful sacramental, and we have those sacramentals such as the blessed cords of St. Joseph and St. Philomena that are sacramentals particularly to obtain the grace of chastity. The last paragraph he has in his section, the virtue contrary to lust is chastity, a moral virtue moderating or excluding the desire to indulge in carnal pleasure, a virtue moderating this desire in the case of the married, and excluding all such desire in the case of the unmarried. Chastity may be the chastity of the unmarried before marriage, that of married people, which is called conjugal chastity, or that of one whose consort has passed away. Chastity is not celibacy nor virginity, and the three must be carefully distinguished, especially when we speak of the three distinct vows in respect to marriage, to the impediments to marriage. So that wraps up this section on the vice of lust. And even though St. Paul says, let it not be named among you, of course, he is saying that meaning we should be so far removed from it. We should have such a horror of it. And of course, we think about the devil, how he must laugh at those souls that he has in his dominion, in his clutches, who become slaves to this vice, because the devil has no body, and consequently would have no experience of these temptations. And it has been said, St. Alphonsus says this, that the more we practice chastity, the more we love that virtue and cultivate that virtue, we become like the angels. Of course, the angels have no body, so we become angelic in a way, we become like them. Let us then, during this season of Lent, as we reflect upon the Passion of Christ, remember that it was especially because of sins of the flesh that our Lord was scourged, that he suffered so much. And let us pray for a horror of this vice and for the grace to do everything we can to shield ourselves from danger.